Unless you've been especially studious in collecting all the early church nun-martyr playing cards, today's dead Christian probably isn't someone you've heard of before. I promise, her story's pretty interesting, even if it does end in a bit of a beheading. But before that, there's some running away from home, some baptism, a little bit of cross-dressing, and collapsing pagan idols everywhere. It's December 23rd, and this is why Eugenia of Rome is a dead Christian you should know about. Eugenia was born at some point in the 3rd century in Alexandria, Egypt. Her father, Philip, was made the prefect of Egypt by the emperor Commodus, who, quick sidebar, was also a wonderful antagonist for Russell Crowe in the movie Gladiator. It's a great movie. You should see it, even if it is a little heavy on the drama and light on the history. Anyway, back to Eugenia and her father, Philip. So, Eugenia was raised in Alexandria in a well-respected home and was noted for her beauty and pleasant disposition, as all good women should be. Of course, because she was the most popular girl at Alexandria High, she had a bunch of illustrious suitors in her entourage. But she decided she'd much rather ditch the marriage route and hang on to her virginity. At some point, in the midst of all these big life decisions, she also became acquainted with the letters of St. Paul, so you know, most of the New Testament, and decided she'd really like to become a Christian. Great, right? The only problem was that Christians weren't allowed in the city of Alexandria. Apparently, Eugenia wasn't a woman to simply give up on her goals. In order to get around this problem, she cooked up a plan. She asked permission to visit one of the family estates outside the city to take in some of the wonderful country air. With permission secured, she left with two of her servants, Protus and Hyacinthus, to somewhere that definitely was not the country house. For reasons that probably made a whole lot of sense at the time, Eugenia dressed up as a man for their trip to a monastery, where all three of them were baptized by a bishop, who knew about Eugenia before he even met her, because he learned all about her in a vision, such as one does. Anyway, the bishop agreed that it made perfect sense for Eugenia to study asceticism at the monastery while disguised as a man. He eventually promoted her, him, to the level of abbot, the man who's in charge of the monastery. How could this possibly go wrong? Monk Eugene, you see what they did there? was such a good student that she acquired the gift of healing. I don't think that's how the gift of healing works, but then again, maybe they meant she learned about medicine, or the laying on of hands, or essential oils. I'm not really sure, but all sorts of sick people were showing up to be healed by Monk Eugene. One day, a rich young woman named Melanthea showed up for a touch of healing from Eugene and found her, even while dressed as a monk and pretending to be a man, really pretty attractive. Boy, this sounds like a few of Shakespeare's comedies. Of course, everyone involved laughed over the simple misunderstanding and carried on about the day with no hard feelings, like responsible adults. Right? Wrong. Eugene rejected Melanthea's romantic advances. Melanthea was crushed. So what did she do? She reported Eugene to the authorities for sexual assault. Uh-oh. Eugene is called to stand before the prefect of Egypt for trial over this alleged assault. You may or may not remember that the prefect of Egypt was none other than Eugenia's father. Eugenia cleared her own name by revealing that she was Eugene, to the delight and possible confusion of her family, who hadn't seen her since she ran away to join the monastery. After the family was reunited, Eugenia's parents and brothers were all baptized. There's only one hitch to the happy ending. Christians were still banned in Alexandria. Philip, Eugenia's father, was denounced by the pagan authorities and dismissed from his job as prefect of Egypt, but was chosen as a bishop by the Alexandrian Christians. The new prefect decided Philip needed to die and sent some men to beat him up. Philip died from his wounds a few days later. After this, Eugenia, her mother Claudia, and her brothers traveled to Rome, where Eugenia continued in the monastic life. Once they were settled there, Claudia built a hostel and helped the poor. As persecution of Christians increased, Claudia and Eugenia sheltered many of the displaced Christians. Eugenia also spent a lot of time in Rome teaching young women Christian doctrine, which led many of them to baptism. One such woman was engaged to a friend of the emperor's, who then complained to the emperor that his would-be bride's new religion preached the denunciation of idols. The emperor ordered Protus and Hyacinthus, remember them, to a temple and attempted to force them to sacrifice to an idol. If you thought Protus and Hyacinthus would cave under such pressure, you'd be wrong. As they entered the temple, the idol fell over and shattered. The Romans, probably being a little upset about their broken statue, beheaded poor Protus and Hyacinthus. Then the emperor ordered Eugenia to the temple of Diana in order to get her to sacrifice to the false goddess. Can you guess what happened? Well, if you guessed that the idol fell over and broke into a billion pieces too, you'd be wrong. The entire temple collapsed. Of course, with the Diana idol in it. After all, statues are made of wood and stone and can't run very fast. Unfortunately, the collapsing temple did not cause the Romans to question their life choices, and instead they tossed Eugenia into a river with a stone around her neck. But, plot twist, the rope spontaneously untied. Then they tried to burn her, but that didn't work either. The next obvious step was to toss her into a pit. But while she was down there, Jesus appeared to her and told her she'd die on the Feast of the Nativity, which came to pass on December 25th, 258, when she was put to death by the sword. So today, we remember Eugenia of Rome, nun, martyr, teacher of the faith, and collapser of temples. Another dead Christian you should know about. Thanks for watching this episode of Dead Christians You Should Know About. Dead Christians is a publication of Higher Things Incorporated. All research, writing, and recording was done by me, Ellie Coro, with animation by Sandra Madden and George Borkhart IV, and character illustrations by Jessica Jacoby. For more information about Dead Christians You Should Know About, or Higher Things, visit our website at www.higherthings.org. Happy St. Eugenia's Day!